string theory just kind of has this problem in spades, in that you're, you know, you're, instead of field, instead of point particles, you have strings. They have a huge number of new degrees of freedom. You have to say that, well, the string vibrations are all happening at such high energies we can't see them. And then the extra 60, then they're trying to use the fact that superstrings have very special properties in 10 dimensions. They, and they're trying to use that to argue that our strings are moving in 10 dimensions, and that four are the ones we see, and six are going to be described particle physics. And so anyways, it becomes a very complicated theory you have to write down in order to kind of make any of this work and make any of this look like physics. And the from the beginning, there was kind of no story about why is anything that looks like the real world going to drop out of this, you know, and you know, why that? And that's still the case 40 years later. And the whole thing just suffers from this problem that you don't actually have the theory. There's kind of a, when you say that you have a string theory and people say, oh, we have this mathematically elegant, well-defined, unique theory, they're talking about, that's not a full theory. That's a perturbative limit of a theory. And so what they really need in order to answer the questions they want to answer is they need something more general, a non-perturbative kind of general version of string theory. And sometimes people now call it M theory. So if you want, we can call it M theory. And they need an M theory. And nobody knows what M theory is. No one has come up. You can write down a list of properties that, you know, M theory is supposed to be some theory with this list of properties, but you can't actually write down a theory. And so on the one hand, you don't actually have a real theory that you can nail down and say, this is a theory, we're going to solve it and look at the solutions and see if they look like the real world. So what people end up doing is saying, well, we don't really know what the theory is. Let's assume that, but it seems that maybe there's one that has some properties that look like the real world. So let's work with that and then try to constrain, see what constraints we can get out of it that will tell us, you know, are we seeing something like the real world? And then they just end up finding that, no, there aren't really useful constraints, that you can get almost anything out of it. So you get this landscape of all possibilities.
Yes.
And then, you know, 20 years ago, things got very weird when people just started to say, well, you know, instead of saying that normally if you have a theory, it can't predict anything because, you know, almost everything is a solution to it, you say, okay, well, that was a bad idea, and you move on. So instead, you saw people saying, oh, well, that's, it just means the real world is, you know, all of these possible things exist in the real world, in the multiverse, and, yeah, and just for, you know, for anthropic reasons, we happen to live in this random one. And, you know, I mean, anyway, it's the fact that anyone ever took any of that seriously is just still kind of, I don't have any explanation for it. It's just far.
Yeah. Okay, so to summarize, somewhere around, this is not a part of the story that was said, but somewhere around the 1960s, some amplitude called the Veneziano, I think, Veneziano. I don't know how to pronounce it.
Yeah,
I just read it.
Veneziano, yeah.
That was the first inklings of string theory, and it had to do, it was come up with because of the strong force. They were trying to solve something. Then it was forgotten about. And then around the 1980s, there were some other problems with string theory that were solved. And so this is the Green-Schwarz anomaly cancellation.
Yeah.
And then some people say that that was the first revolution, but it's also more accurate to say that that precipitated Ed Witten to take it seriously. And then that's what precipitated the first string revolution.
Yeah.
Okay. Then from there, then you realize that there are different ways, something like 5 to the 100 or 10 to the 500 or some extreme amount that if you were to do some napkin calculation, all those books behind you, the amount of words ever written, not just books ever published, words ever written, I think easily letters ever written, like single letters, it would be like saying, find this one letter in every single book that's ever been written, including all the ones that have been on fire and underwater and so on. Okay, that's not such a problem if you can figure out how to reduce the search space. But if you can't, then it turns out the problem is NP complete, which means you just have to brute force. Is that a correct summary?
Well, actually, maybe to go back to one thing and say, yeah, so this is one part of the story I didn't say, is that string theory had originally come out as a potential theory of the strong interactions. And that actually was one reason Woit, I think, was looking at it, is that, so one of the open problems that the standard model left open was, how do you solve the strong, we had this strong interaction theory, but how do you solve it? And it looked like maybe you could use the old ideas about strings to solve it. And I actually spent a lot of time learning about strings as a graduate student because of that. And I was really to win. But the problem with this kind of multiplicity of solutions of string theory of is that it's not just that there are too many of them. It's just that you don't actually have a definition of the problem. You know, so people, this kind of drives me crazy. People often talk about, well, the problem is that we don't know how to put a measure on the space of solutions of string theory. And if we could put a measure, then we could figure out, you know, maybe it's concentrated someplace.
Right.
Near, and that would be great. But I keep pointing out that the problem is not that you don't have a measure of the space. The problem is that you have no idea what the space is. As I was saying, to even define what a string theory solution is requires knowing precisely what M theory is. You don't know it. There are no equations anyone can write down, which you say, you know, if we were smart enough and we look and could find all the solutions to this, this would, you know, these are all the solutions of string theory. I mean, you just don't have that. So all of the things that you do have, like you can go out and say, well, maybe it's these gadgets and you have 10 of the 500 of them or whatever. Those are all just kind of cooked together possible approximations to what you think might be a string theory solution. Those are not, there aren't, you know, they're solutions to some equations you've written down, which are not, they are not the equations of string theory. There's something you wrote down and think maybe these things have something to do with string theory. So the problem is much worse than any of these practical problems of there's too many of these things.
Great. Yeah.
And this whole business, and now it's become kind of an industry that, well, let's apply machine learning techniques to this. And it's just, I mean, you're just applying, anyway, you're just.
Does this frustrate you?
Yes. I mean, this data is garbage, you know, so you basically are throwing, you basically do not actually know what your problem is. So you're cooking up something which you can feed to a computer, but it actually is kind of known to be garbage, and you're doing processing on this and producing more garbage, and you know, getting grants to do this and going around telling people that you're looking for the universe. I mean, it's real. That's just utter nonsense. I'm sorry.
Many people don't know because they don't know the history. But since 2010s, it's become somewhat cool to dunk on string theory, at least in the popular press.
Okay,
maybe not inside academia. But you were a lone, you and Lee Smolin were lone wolves, early lone wolves.
Yeah, yeah.
Can you talk about that and talk about some of the flack you took, maybe still take?
Yeah, anyway, it was certainly a very strange experience, a very strange time. But, you know, I think the thing to say is that, you know, throughout, you know, I was always fairly skeptical about string theory. But, you know, initially for many years, my attitude was, well, you know, who knows? You know, Woit's certainly very smart. These people are, you know, they're gonna sooner or later they'll figure out for them. Either they'll figure out this works, or they'll do something else. But then, you know, just as time went by, years went by, and then this was just not happening. And you had more and more kind of popular books. You know, I have to confess, maybe in some sense it's somewhat of a reaction to Brian Greene, who is my friend and colleague here in at Columbia. But you know, so he did a very, very good job of, with PBS specials, convincing the world that, you know, this was a successful, this was an idea on the way to success when it really wasn't. So mm-hmm. I thought, okay, well, somebody should, you know, sit down and write a book about, you know, what the real situation here is. And it's not like when I talk to people privately about this, you know, I would say that people who are not string theorists mostly would say, yeah, you know, yeah, you're probably right. This doesn't seem to be going anywhere, but you know, whatever. And then when I talk to string theorists, I have plenty of string theorist friends, they would often say, yeah, you know, yeah, there are a lot of huge problems and we don't really know anything better to do right now. So we're going to keep doing this, but yeah, yeah, all these problems you're pointing out are really, they're real. And,
so what's wrong with that?
Well, it was, The weird thing was, I think, was this disjunction between the private opinions of people, what people were saying to each other privately, what you, private housing, and what you were seeing in the popular press. And, you know, and one aspect of this was people not wanting to kind of publicly criticize something. And I think the subject became more and more kind of ideological, and the, you know, string theorists kind of started to feel kind of embattled. They were very well aware that a lot of their colleagues thought what they were doing was not working. On the other hand, you know, so they became more defensive, and there was a lot more. It became, and a lot of people, I think, would tell me, I agree with a lot of your saying, but don't quote me on this publicly. I don't want to get involved in, you know, in that mess and alienating a lot of my colleagues and who are. Anyway, I have this weird status that I'm actually in a math department, not a physics department. And, you know, I don't have a lot of the same reasons that you don't want to annoy some powerful people in physics, like, you know, trying to get grants, get your students jobs, et cetera, didn't really apply to me. So I thought, well, you know, if somebody is going to kind of explain what's going on here, it might as well be me. And, you know, I spent a lot of time thinking about this stuff. And so I started writing this in around 2002, 2003. And the book was finally published. It was a long story about getting it published, but it finally got published in 2006. And in the meantime, Lee Smolin had been writing a book. He was coming from a different direction.
Trouble with Physics?
Yeah, The Trouble with Physics. And he was, he had his own motivations. It was trying to write something, I think, more general and sociological, but with this as an example. And I think the way he describes it, the example kind of took over the general theory. And so he ended up also writing a book about string theory, and the books ended up coming out at the same time, which I think, you know, it was kind of a force multiplier there that, you know, people, if one person is writing a book which says, well, you know, a lot of the things you're hearing are not right, or people say, well, that's just one person's opinion. But if two people are saying things, everybody's like, oh, you know, there must be something to this. And so I think the combination of the two books, I think, you know, it did have a lot of effect on, it did make a lot of people realize there was a problem here. It made a lot of the string theorists, you know, much more defensive. I mean, it also caused, I think, a lot of people, young people thinking of doing string theory or people doing string theory, to decide to move on to something else. But, so people very often tell me that, you know, about effects this book had on them or other people they knew, in terms of their decisions about, you know, what to do with their research or their career.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.